At this time, I would like to introduce and give great thanks to our sheriff, Donna Buckley.
Good morning. Welcome to Big Nick's Ride for the Fallen. This amazing event was created 15 years ago by the Cape Cod Law Dogs and Gold Star family, Representative Steve Ixaros. At the Barnstable County Sheriff's Office, we are proud to host the opening ceremony of this event that honors our local heroes, the service members from Cape Cod who died fighting for our country since November 11th, 2001. I want to take a moment to give a thanks to the Barnstable County Sheriff's Office staff. The planning for this event starts the day after the ride. To Major Kevin Fernandez and all of the staff from the Barnstable County Sheriff's Office who make these opening ceremonies happen, thank you. Big Nick's Ride brings us together. Everyone here is united by tremendous love, sadness, and gratitude for the 16 Cape Cod fallen. To the 16 Gold Star families, no words can describe your sacrifice. Your pain never ends. Our gratitude is just as boundless. As Americans, we owe it to the men and women who died courageously, fighting against terrorism, to do what we can to protect our rights here at home. We are all capable of contributing in some way, and we are doing that here today as we ride to honor and remember our local heroes and their families. So thank you all for showing up and caring and remembering. And now I would like to invite to this microphone Representative Steve Ixaros for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Thank you, Sheriff Buckley. Everyone, let's do the Pledge of Allegiance. And how we do it, we're gonna face the color guard flag, American flag. Veterans, you stand tall and you can salute. Everybody else, hats off, hand over your heart. And we do it loud, and we do it proud. We do it with meaning, because that is old glory, and we are the greatest country on earth. The Pledge of Allegiance, ready. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Amen. Thank you. Now I would like to introduce our singer of our national anthem, Miss Michelle Brooks Thompson.
Say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and marine stars perilous fight. Oh, the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' bright glare, the bombs bursting was still here.
Thank you, Michelle. It's beautiful. This time, I would ask the honor guards to retire the colors.
Honor guards, forward, march!
To invite former U.S. Army Chaplain Amanda Braga Tipton to open us in prayer.
Good morning, all you beautiful people. So normally I have so much to say, and this morning I don't, so you're welcome for that. But this morning, there was this story that kept coming to my mind from the Bible. And basically, the situation was people had been under oppression for a long time, and they had lost hope. And so they had begun hiding in caves. They were hiding in caves, and they forgot who they were. They had labels that were upon them. I'm so sorry, my phone is going off. They had placed labels upon themselves, maybe because someone had said to them, oh, you're not good enough, or you're not going to advance. Or they had just begun believing lies from everyday life. And so they were hiding in caves, when in actuality, they were called to the forefront because there were warriors that were hidden inside of them that had just been buried deep. And so this morning as I was driving here, I just thought, man, can't that be in any sphere of our lives? Where maybe you're standing here, I'm standing here today with a label that I've placed on myself that's not true, but I'm believing it, so it's become my truth. About 13 months ago, I'm lying, about 12 months ago, my brother, U.S. Army veteran Sergeant Joshua Tipton, he died by suicide. He became one of the 22. And in the past 370 days, there's been a lot of processing and thinking over this. What lie was my brother believing that became his truth? And so that's all I want to present to you today. Is are there any lies that maybe you're believing that have become your truth and you're walking that out, but it's not the truth? Because truth actually sets us free and brings us into levels of greater freedom and liberty in our lives, in every sphere. And so I'm just asking you that maybe in your own life, are you hiding in a cave somewhere? Have you given up? Do you hear the sound of the enemy taunting? And just thinking, nah, I can't do that. Well, I'm here to say, you can do that. So that's what I'm going to pray today. Over us as a company of people here. And over us as a nation. That is in great need of truth to keep marching forward. So gracious God, giver of life. Giver of grace, so much grace, one who heals, one who can deliver, one who can save, one who can redeem, one who comforts. Unto you in this moment, I beseech your hand upon each and every person that is here in their families. That if anyone here is hiding in a cave somewhere when they're supposed to be out on the proverbial battlefield, God, that today they would walk out of the cave. They would pick up their own armor and they would stand and they would fulfill the callings upon their lives, the purposes and the destinies upon each life here, God. That no lie would reign supreme within our hearts, but only truth. And yet again, God, I place before you this great country that we have been blessed to call our home. And from the north, the south, the east, and the West, I ask again that the sound of freedom would reign supreme. In the name above every name, amen.
At this time, we're going to have the reading of the names of the 16 fallen, which will be done by U.S. Marine Tad Duart. After each name is read, there'll be the ringing of the bell, which will be done by United States Marine Mike McGee. And after each name is read, the salute will be done by Army Combat Veteran Dave Capisano. And after the 16 names have been read, Skip Gummo will perform taps.
In front of me are 16 names of young men and young women who put their lives on the line for us to be here today. These young women and men are buried, laying in rest, just across the street amongst those trees in our great national cemetery. U.S. Army Staff Sergeant Alicia Burkett of Mashpee. U.S. Army Private First Class Paul Conlon of Mashpee. U.S. Navy Captain Gerald DeConto of Sandwich. U.S. Army Sergeant Alexander Fuller of Barnstable. U.S. Army Sergeant Matthew Gallagher of Falmouth. U.S. Navy SEAL Kevin Houston of Barnstable. U.S. Marine Captain Eric Jones of Mashpee. U.S. Marine Corps Private First Class Beckett Kierman of Falmouth. U.S. Marine Private First Class Daniel McGuire of Mashpee. U.S. Army Sergeant Matthew Pacino of Bourne. U.S. Army Staff Sergeant Stephen Sprague of Yarmouth. U.S. Army Private First Class Clinton Springer II of Bourne. U.S. Army Sergeant Zachary Tiller of Falmouth. U.S. Army Sergeant Mark Vecchione of Eastham. U.S. Navy Commander Francis T. Williams of Sandwich. U.S. Marine Corps Corporal Nicholas Exaros of Yarmouth.
I would like to welcome to the stage State Representative David Veer to do a special presentation.
Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Good morning.
It's a beautiful day. It didn't start that way. Woke up this morning, clouds, fog, a little rain. That a little wind came in off the ocean. The rain went out to the bay. The sun came out. We just read the names of 16 Cape Cod loved ones whose families one day woke up in the clouds and the rain. Some may still be in those overcast skies. Others, the dawn is coming, the light is breaking. And for some, we hope the sun is shining again. And it's kind of a metaphor of what we're here for today. An individual that I had the honor to work with when I was with the Barnstable County Sheriff's Office. And he was with the Yarmouth Police Department. Woke up to sunny days. Till that one fateful day. When Big Nick made the ultimate sacrifice for our freedoms and for our country. And as the clouds started to move away, Steve was trying to figure out, how do I make sense of this, like you all do, all of our Gold Star families, and what can I do? And one of the greatest things, Steve, that I'm so proud to be here today is that you created a sense of hope, not just for the families, but a sense of the hope for the hundreds of individuals and families that this organization supports. When I watch you on Facebook Live, because it happens a lot, I see where you are and the lives that you're touching with the funds that are raised through this organization and other events. And so today, being the 15th anniversary, we tend in the legislature not to give out citations to our colleagues, right? You're patting your, not one politician patting another on the back. But that's not why I'm here today. I'm here today to pat a Gold Star father on the back and an organization that looks to bring hope when you feel like there's no hope. When an organization that brings honor and integrity to those that have served, and an organization that is only 15 years old. But by looking at the crowd today and those still driving in, will last for many more. So today, on behalf of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, be it hereby known to all that the Massachusetts House of Representatives offers its sincerest congratulations to Big Nick's Ride for the Fallen in recognition of your 15 years of honoring those who have made the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom and all who have served and defended our great nation in the armed forces. The dedication and hard work that go into organizing this event each year are a true reflection of our community's respect and gratitude. The entire membership extends its very best wishes and extends a hope for future good fortune and continued success in all endeavors, given the 21st day of July, signed by the Speaker of the House and Representative Vieira, ranking member of Homeland Security. Steve, keep up the good work.
Too far. We'd like to bring up back to the podium Gold Star father and our friend Steve Xaros to introduce our guest speakers this morning.
Thank you. July 23rd, 2009 was the worst day of my life. My son and his brothers were fighting for freedom in Afghanistan. And I was called to come to the police station. I didn't know why. And when I arrived, Marines gave me the news that Nick had been killed in Afghanistan. I made some type of horrible noise that came out of my body and I hit the floor. And my brothers at the police department picked me up and my sisters. They gave me strength. And then we had to go to my home to tell my family. 15 years ago, on this Tuesday, and I walked to that front door and I saw my family inside, and I didn't want to go in. But I knew I had to. And I opened that door and I broke their hearts. But you gave us strength. The sound of the motorcycles in the funeral made us know we were not alone. And in 15 years, we've helped hundreds of people, and it all comes from the sound of a motorcycle. And here we are today, and I am stronger than ever. My family is stronger than ever because of you. So we are a Gold Star family, just like those over here, and just like those all over our great country. My proudest moment today will be to introduce combat Marines that were there. So at this point, I would like any Marine to come up and stand with me. If you are a Marine, please come up. We honor all our military, every branch, but today, Marines, come on up. Something. So remember, every branch of the military fights for freedom. Nick is a Marine. These Marines come, they give us strength. They've never left our side. And today I got to introduce one of them to the others, and that Marine had not seen them since the summer of 2009. So that's what's on the stage here. We have two speakers that are going to tell us, teach us, the price of freedom. The first one is my friend who came all the way from Long Island with his family and gave Nick's eulogy at Camp Lejeune. United States Marine, Matt Gabriel.
My name is Sergeant Matthew Gabriel, and 18 years ago, I earned the title of United States Marine. I joined the Marines on November 12, 2006, and served in 2nd Battalion, 8th Marines for 4 years, and went on two combat deployments, one to Iraq, one to Afghanistan. 15 years. It always amazes me that one event in one day can change the course of your life forever. We are all here 15 years later because of one event. This is my third time speaking on behalf of my brother Nick, and hopefully not my last. I spoke on his behalf at our own makeshift memorial in Afghanistan, and again when we got back from the deployment when I volunteered to give his eulogy at the memorial services for all Marines lost in our deployment. It was an honor to speak at those events, and it's an honor to speak to all of you today. Two Marines gave their life for this country on July 23, 2009 in Garmshire, Afghanistan. Nick Exaros and Jeremy Lasher. All of you know who Nick is. Many of you don't know Nick Jeremy, and that's okay. I will gladly tell you all I know in this speech. I'm here today to tell you about my relationship with those brave men, my firsthand account from that day, the moments during the event, the aftermath that followed. I apologize in advance if I get a little graphic in my account and if I get emotional while I talk. As you can imagine, this is not an easy topic. I will be fully transparent with all of you and tell you I knew Nick for a grand total of 4 months. During those 4 months, I maybe spent 3 months being with him in person. Most of that time was the 1 month we had to acclimate to the harsh Afghanistan weather, but we ate every meal together, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. We swapped stories about our yayas and talked about our girls back home. He is the very reason I had the courage to ask my now wife of 13 years to marry me, but more on that later. Despite the fact that I had only known him for a short time, from the day I met him, I had made a lifelong friend. I remember the day he was introduced to our platoon, and they told us he was coming over from 1-9, who had taken over for us in Ramadi, Iraq. After the brief was over, I walked over to him and introduced myself and told him I was a fellow Greek. Since it was plain to me, he was too, just completely judging his last name. His eyes widened and he smiled and shook my hand, and I like to think it gave him a sense of comfort knowing that our platoon was a family environment and that we all knew each other inside and out. The day after he was introduced to our platoon, our commander pulled Nick and I aside and told us he wanted Nick to become the vehicle commander of the truck I was in charge of, and I would become the vehicle commander in the other section. It made logical sense to pair him with a more experienced truck, but that decision, unbeknown to all of us, changed the course of our history forever. If that switch was never made, I'd be not standing here in front of all of you. I wrestle with that to this day. What if Nick didn't volunteer to come on the deployment? Would have that been my fate? Why me? Why did I get to live and someone so amazing have to leave this world at the young age of 21? I just tell myself that I'm on borrowed time and try to make the most of my life because in my mind at times, I feel like I don't really deserve to live it. I carry him with me everywhere I go, and I feel it's at least I could do for him since he gave everything for all of us. I knew last year for a little over a year's time, he had deployed to Iraq in Echo Company, but he came to Weapons Platoon before the Afghanistan workup. I went to numerous training sessions with him and often ate breakfast with him through morning PT. He was a very reserved Marine by Marine standards, but when he offered his input on a situation, you listened to what he had to say. Jeremy Lasher was 30 years old when he paid the ultimate sacrifice for our country. He left behind his wife, Andrea, and his one-year-old son, Caden, who was one at the time. He loved his wife and adored his son, and he was genuinely just an all-around great person and an even better Marine. I am extremely grateful to have known these men and fortunate to have fought beside them. The morning of July 23rd was like most mornings in Afghanistan, waking up at Forward Operating Base named after our first casualty, PFC Sharp. It was 120 degrees, sandy, and I hadn't showered for a few weeks. We had been in the fight that month on numerous occasions, and my section, CAT 1, which stands for Combined Anti-Armor Team, was ready to swap out with our other section, CAT 2, which just so happened to be Nick and Jeremy's. We would swap every week or 10 days to go to a more established base to get some hot food and a shower. As CAT 2 came, they were also escorting a supply train, which was bringing fresh supplies to the FOB I was then staying at. They came in through the same road we'd always come down, which had one blind spot between the FOB and the desert where we had trucks on overwatch. This line of sight was to be able to secure the roads with no insurgents can bury IEDs without us seeing them. But as I said, there was one blind spot. So CAT 2 was coming up on the FOB when the road gave way under the lead truck and it became stuck and blocked the road. None of the trucks present were equipped with a big enough tow strap, except for one in the supply train which was back keeping overwatch in the desert. So someone had to go and get that strap so we could preserve the lead truck and successfully resupply Echo Company Marines. The last two vehicles in CAT 2 were Nick's truck and Sergeant Spaulding's, and they were tasked to retrieve the strap. As they drove off, Nick's truck sped ahead of Spaulding's and started the journey down that same road to the desert. I was helping assess how we were going to pull that lead truck out when all of a sudden there was a massive explosion came down from the road. We all stopped in our tracks and heard over the radio that it was an IED and the truck was catastrophic, which means that it significantly damaged or totaled. I raced to my truck with my guys and booked it to the site, and we were the second truck on the scene. I got a stretcher and ran as fast as I could. When I got there, the scene was something out of a movie. I saw two Marines wrestling Doc Parr to try to take care of him, but he wanted to do his job and help the downed Marines. But because of the adrenaline running through him, he didn't know he had multiple broken bones in his feet. The next thing I saw and heard was the blood-curdling screams of Dominic Davila and a Marine resetting his half-blown-off leg, and the turret he once sat in right behind him completely blown off the truck in the field. I saw Spaulding with Dom and asked him where he needed me to go, and he said, "Go to Nick, he's over there in the field." I saw him and I ran as fast as I could. He was in and out of consciousness. I kept talking to him, but he couldn't talk back. I surveyed him for cuts and lacerations, and he had minimal scratches, and there was nothing close to life-threatening. But then I noticed his stomach looked like he had a balloon inside of it, and his wounds were internal, and there was nothing I could do to help him. I saw the pain in his face when he came to for a few seconds here and there, and that image will forever be indented in my brain. I flicked his eyes to get him to wake up and notice me, and I told him he would be okay, and that I would protect him as long as I could. I told him, "I got you, man. I'm here. I love you, bro. You're gonna be okay. Just stay awake. Stay with me." I told him, "I'm gonna take your advice and definitely propose when I get back." He told me during our time at Camp Leatherneck together that if, and I quote, I know she's the one. Stop thinking about it and just be with her. Don't be a bitch, bro. I held him and I covered him with my body as sand flew everywhere when the helicopter arrived for the medevac. I put him on the stretcher and carried him and his gear over farmland that had 10-inch crop mounds every 2 feet. I mustered every ounce of strength that I had to carry him to the bird. With every step, I saw the space fence. I kept telling him, you're good now. You're going to the hospital. They'll make you all right. I'll see you soon, bro. As the bird flew away, I must admit, I had hope, because when you put a guy in a chopper in a movie, they always live. I was that naive. But that was the last time I saw him. As the chopper went out of sight, I turned and realized I had seen everyone from that truck except Lasher. I walked up to Corporal Domes, who was about as naturally pale as they come, but he was beet red. I asked him where Lasher is, and he said one word back, everywhere, which stunned me to my core. I couldn't function for a few minutes, and then I was told I would be going back to the FOB while the rest of the platoon stayed on the road so I can inventory the gear that for the Marines that got medevaced. It wasn't something I wanted to do, but I had to be done. The next morning, my vehicle supplied the rest of the platoon with food and water, and we took our place on the road. A new supply train had come down that morning, and they stopped by our truck for a few minutes. The lieutenant got out and started talking to my staff sergeant, and all I heard was, oh my God, no. It was at that moment I had learned that Nip did not survive the night and succumbed to his internal wounds. I broke down immediately. A huge wave of grief and sadness swept through me as I sobbed like I never sobbed in my life. I put him on the helicopter myself, I remember thinking. He was supposed to be okay and meet us home. After I was able to gather myself, I went to the my guys and broke the news to them. As you can imagine, everyone felt that gut punch, especially after losing Lasher not even 24 hours ago. Nick was only with us for a short time, but he left a lifetime of memories with all of us from 2-8. There are moments in life you take for granted because you're simply living, like having a drink with close friends. I never got to have a drink with Nick, never got to live it up with him and see him outside the Corps. I think I can speak for my entire platoon when I say envy the Marines he served with during his first 3 years in the Corps before he came to 2-8. You got to experience the best of him and live life with him. Your memories of parties and good times will always be with you, and I truly hope you treasure them. It is so awesome to see the same faces each time I come here. I see the support you give Steve and Lisa and the guidance you give Alex, Ashley, and Lizzie. And I just want to thank you and tell you for what it's worth. You're doing great work and keep celebrating his life. I met the Exaros family for the first time right before the battalion memorial service since I was slated to speak on Nick's behalf. I got to receive his family at the front gate of Camp Lejeune. It was a surreal experience to meet his family without him there to make introductions. But Steve, Lisa, Alex, Ashley, and Lizzie are incredible people and were nothing short of extraordinary during that time and made me feel like part of the family. I don't know about all of you, but I believe in God and that he has a plan. You may not always see his vision, but when you look closely, it's there. For me, it was significant dates that are part of my story. While in Afghanistan, I had my own brush with death on September 24th, 2009, when my vehicle ran over an IED and blew up directly under my seat, and it left its mark on my body. My wife and I had our first child, Eva Catherine, on September 24th, 2015, the very same day. I got yet another new lease on life. Sorry. I got out of the Marine Corps on November 12th, 2010, and 7 years later, on November 12th, 2017, my second child, Layla Rose, was born. I now have a son who was born on September 17th, and while that date doesn't have the same correlated significance as both my daughters, his name does, and that is Luke Nicholas. I want to thank you all for allowing me to speak to you today, and I want to close on something that I hope we can all agree on. Many, if not all of you, have watched or heard of the show Game of Thrones. In the show, there are men who make up the Night's Watch and protect the realm from evil beyond the wall. When one of those men dies, they say, and now his watch has ended. But I don't believe that's the case with Nick and Jeremy. I believe that their watch started on July 29th, 2009, and that they have guided and protected each and every one of us. They will continue to watch over us until we join them once again. Eternal be their memory, Semper Fi, and God bless.
I've never heard that story. So to carry it forward, I want to introduce our last speaker, Nick's high school classmate. Nick's brother, who is now, you know, our family, our son. And he came home and he is one of the strongest, most resilient human beings I've ever met. And he has blessed us with a book that he wrote about that summer and that mission. He lives here on Cape Cod. He is a Yarmouth police officer. Him and Alex went to the police academy together, and now they serve together. Andrew Coville, please step up.
It's a real privilege to be able to speak in front of everybody here, and I really appreciate you all coming out. When Nick and I joined the Marines in 2006 and stood on those yellow footprints, I would have never imagined what it turned into this. My friend Nick and I joined the Marines right out of high school in 2006. We both deployed to Afghanistan in the summer of 2009 with different battalions but operated in the same area. I came home from Afghanistan and went on to live my life after the Marines, while Nick came home with an American flag draped coffin and now resides in the War National Cemetery, forever 21 years old, right across the street. I wanted to share my story as a testament to any young people who went to war and lost friends. The backdrop of Afghanistan could be replaced with any war America sent its youth to go fight in. Serving in a combat zone as a United States Marine is the greatest privilege I've ever had. And I just wanted people to understand the depth of realities that come along with our youth fighting for the freedoms we all have. I recently reconnected with several people from that deployment, one of them being Brigadier General Lawrence Nicholson, who was in charge of the entire operation Nick and I were a part of. And I think it's really important for people to remember that the entire war on terror was an all-volunteer military force. Every single person who deployed was there because they wanted to be there, and they were there to uphold the ideals that America stand for and give their lives if necessary for those ideals. There's a 10-year reunion held for Operation Qanjar, which was the Marine Expeditionary Brigade in 2009 that Nick and I were a part of. When I reconnected with the general, he sent me his address, and I thought there's an important piece to take out of it to read to you all that I think sums up that all-volunteer generation. The general said, "We will forever mourn the loss of each fallen comrade. We will more importantly honor and celebrate their lives, their service, their innumerable contributions and accomplishments, and most importantly, their noble sacrifice. The greatest concern I constantly saw in speaking with recently wounded Marines did not involve the personal injury sustained nor any concern of self, but rather the alarming prospect of being separated from their units, leaving their brothers and teammates behind as they got medevaced out of theater. My team needs me," was the most common refrain he heard. You know, it's really impressive to me as time has gone on to see all the Marines of that time frame and what they've accomplished and what they've made it through. And a big part of me releasing that book and telling my story was to take control of that narrative for myself and try to turn it into something positive that may help somebody else. And that was my only intention. And to see my friends doing the things they're doing now and to be turning this corner in life where we finally start talking about these things in a productive manner is extremely powerful to me and makes it worth every single thing I went through. I love Nick. I miss him every single day. But I just remind myself that he made a sacrifice so that others didn't have to, and he, you know, put his hand in there and said, "I'll go, send me." And I miss him every day. I thank you all for the support you've given and coming out here every year, and everyone who volunteers to keep this going and to keep Nick's memory alive and the other 16 fallen service members. I don't want to forget to mention them. They died for the same ideals and made the same sacrifice. I just didn't personally know them, so my only experience is with Nick. Thank you all.
Iron sharpens iron. All of you that have served our country, thank you. In every branch. And to all the Gold Star families, we are one.
before we go to our bikes and before we show Cape Cod what it looks like to be free and let them hear the sounds of the motorcycles, we will end with a song called Hero. Michelle, could you please come through? And everybody, please stand. Marines, stay right here. Michelle.
Ooh. how we do it. God bless you. God bless America. Let's go to the bikes and let's ride.